Hello everyone, Thanas here with ActionVFX.
In this tutorial, I'm going to introduce you to rotoscoping in Nuke. We're gonna take a look at how the Roto node works and the different ways to implement it to your rotoscoping workflow. This is not a step-by-step on how I rotoscoped this particular shot, but this tutorial will just be an introduction to the general workflows that I used.
Before we move forward with the video, don't forget to hit the subscribe button and hit the notification icon so you will not miss out on more contents like this one.
So, without further ado, let's begin. Okay, so here we are in Nuke. I have this plate from filmpack.com. So first, of course, we want to bring out the Roto node. So let's press tab and search for Roto, or you can just press O for the shortcut. Now, let's take a look at this node. So on the left here, we have all the different tools to create our Roto shape. So first, let's start from the bottom. Let's hold this, and we have all the different tools and shapes that we can use to create our Roto. For now, we're just going to select Bezier, and then we want to start drawing. If you want to draw very sharp lines, you can just click and start drawing. But if you want to create a smooth line, you can just hold click and drag. And then you want to make sure you want to create a closed shape. And then here on the other tools, we have this pen icon, and we have all the different tools that we can use, like for example, add points to add more points to the shapes that you just created, or maybe smooth points or cusp points to turn the sharp edges into smooth or vice versa. And of course, we have remove point to remove point. And then we have this cursor to basically just different ways to select your shape. So here, even though we have drawn our shape, we cannot see anything. It's all just black. The reason is because on our Roto node, we have our output as alpha, meaning that whatever we are drawing it only on the alpha channel. So to look at what we just drew, we can just change our display of the monitor to alpha, and we can see our shape. And then here we have pre-multiply, which we will talk a bit more later. And then we have the clip to, which currently set to format. So what that means is that when you draw your Roto outside of this format bounds, and then say you add a transform node after this Roto, and then you move it here, and let's take a look at the alpha channel, press A, you will see that we have our Roto that is on the edge clipped by this bounding box that is on the size of our project format. So to deal with this, what we can do is to change the clip to something like no clip. And there we go. Now our Roto doesn't have any bounds, and you can draw it anywhere you want and you will keep your alpha. And then here we have the opacity of the Roto shape. And then we have feather to feather the edge of the Roto. And then we have feather fall off, which controls the amount of fall off that you have on the feathering. You can also do the feather manually by just clicking this pointy line here and just drag it out. So that way you can do the feathering on each individual points separately instead of everything at the same time. And then of course we have our keyframe here, which you can use to add a keyframe and then of course delete a keyframe. One thing to keep in mind with the Roto node, whenever you draw a shape, it would automatically create a keyframe of that shape on that frame. So you want to keep in mind where you draw your shape. And then also when you move to another frame and then you make some adjustment, it would create another keyframe there automatically. So it would animate. So you want to make sure to keep in mind where you add your keyframes and remember that. Or if you want to make some adjustment to your Roto shape, you can turn on the ripple effect here on the Roto to enable you to adjust the point of a shape and have that change affect the entire keyframes. And then of course here we have the list of all the Roto shapes that we just created. Because when rotoscoping, you're going to use a lot of shapes, so this helps keep in track of all the stuff that you just made. So now let's learn about all the settings on this side here. First, of course, we have the visibility button, and then we have the lock button to prevent it from being selected. And then we have the spline handle color. So if we click this and let's change the color here, you see that our spline color here has changed from red to blue. And then next we have the color fill for the inside of the shape. So if we change here to say red and let's switch this back to the RGB channel, we don't have anything. That is because our output is currently alpha. So if we change this to say RGB, we will have our red color that we assigned here. And then here we have the blending modes, which is how these rotos interact with each other. Currently, we have this all set to over. So when these roto overlapped, it would just going to stack on top of each other. But if we change this to, let's say, exclusion, you would see it's going to subtract. And then here we have motion blur, which pretty self-explanatory. If you turn this on and you animate your roto, it's going to have motion blur when it's moving. And then here we have life, which basically just the longevity of the roto. Currently it's set to all, so this roto is present the entire time, but we can change that to say like start to this current frame, so it's going to be present for this entire time until we passed the frame that we set it to. Or it can also only appear for a single frame, or you can also set your own frame range. You can control this on this lifetime tab. And then here we have color, which we are not going to deal with now because we are focusing on the roto node, and this deals more with roto paint. And then of course, we have all these different tabs, but for this, we are going to focus on transform. This transform tab is useful if you want to just move the shape around without affecting the keyframes of the actual curves. So for example, you may want to copy some tracking data from the tracker nodes into these settings. Or if you're like me, I rarely use this transform tab settings, but instead I do my transformation on a separate transform node after this roto. I like this way because it gives me a strong visual cue on what's happening with my script. So now that we know how the roto node works, let's learn how we can use it to rotoscope our plate. So the key workflow of rotoscoping is we want to generate an alpha mat from the roto node and use that alpha to cut our footage or plate. And you can do that in many different ways. There's no right way to do this, so I'm just going to show you three ways to roto that you can try out. So the first one is the more streamlined workflow, which is just a normal node stacking. So you want to input the plate that you want to roto into the background input of the roto node, and then you want to draw your shapes, and then you want to keep the output to alpha, and then we want to set the pre-multiply also to alpha. That way we have the RGB channel of the original plate and also the alpha channel from the roto existing on the same stream, but not yet multiplied. So this way, what you can do is you can add, say, a blur node right after the roto, and we want to set the channels to alpha, and then increase the blur to blur out the alpha channel without affecting the RGB channel of the plate. And then once we have the alpha channel the way that we like it, we can then add a pre-mult node to essentially combine the alpha channel with the RGB. So the benefits of doing this roto workflow is that you have a very streamlined roto tree, and that may be something that you prefer to have in your workspace. However, in this workflow, if you want to play around with the transformation, like adding a tracking data or transformation data, you have to do it on the transform tab. Because if you're doing it on the stream, you're going to affect the RGB channel as well. And then the second workflow that you can do is you can do it in a branched way. So here I have this roto on a different branch than the plate. And then I plugged in the roto to the A input of this copy node where the plate is plugged in into the B input. So what's happening with this is that we are copying or replacing the alpha channel of this B stream with the alpha channel of this A stream, which is the roto. So we are back to where we were with the previous workflow. And then you can add the pre-mult to multiply the alpha channel with the RGB. So the benefit of separating the roto branch is that it gives us a bit more broken down workflow of our script. So for example, I can add a transform node here and transform my alpha without affecting the RGB. Or maybe you want to merge in another roto or alpha mat into the mix. So this is why it is my preferred workflow, because it gives me a bit more elaborate way to do things. But again, this may not be your preferred workflow, and that is fine. The downside of doing it this way is, of course, if you are adding a bunch of tree branching on the A side here, it can get a bit messy, and you may not want to have that. A variation of this separate branch workflow that I often do also is, instead of using a copy node, I'm using a merge node that I set to mask. That way, I don't have to add pre-mult to multiply the RGB with the alpha channel. The difference between using the copy and the merge mask is that The merge node does not actually copy the alpha channel to the B stream, but instead it just uses the alpha channel of the A stream to cut out the alpha channel that exists on the B stream. Of course, all three of these workflows have their own pros and cons. It's really up to you to use which one. Okay, so now let's go to an example of implementing this to an actual Roto shop. A year ago, I made a video on 6 major rotoscoping tips where I mentioned the importance of breaking your roto shapes or motion tracking in rotoscoping, among other tips. So like I mentioned in that quick tip video, you want to break up your roto shape into simple core shapes, and you want to motion track the different elements of the scene to save you from manually rotoscoping everything. So for example, instead of rotoscoping this entire helmet as one big shape, you want to break it down into different pieces. For example, you may want to roto this bowl and the straps on the helmet as different shapes. So let's get our roto node, and then we're going to draw a shape. But then instead of like manually moving your roto to follow the strap, what we're going to do is to do some motion tracking on this area. So go to the tracker node and we want to track that part. So for this, we just want the translation data, which is the X and Y movement. So let's check the T here. And then what we can do is we can go to the transform, copy this translate and center to the transform on the roto node. But because I like using the branched workflow for my roto, I can just go to the tracker export here and let's select transform match move and generate a transform node from the tracker and then just plug in to the roto. So here this green line means this transform node doesn't have actual keyframes on it. It's just following whatever it is that we have on this tracker node. You can also do again match move bait to create a transform node with its own keyframe that is not connected to the tracker node. So because we are doing the branch workflow, let's get the copy node put here. So we have the B plugged into the plate and the A, we want to plug it in to our roto. So now we have the transform node here connected to our roto. What we can do is just draw a shape and then it would automatically already following our plate. So this way we just saved us a lot of time and keyframes when doing our roto. One thing that can really help you to really know how accurate your roto is, other than seeing the final result being pre-melted, is also by using overlay. So let's disable the pre-melt here for now. And let's go here and select matte overlay. So here we created this color that follows the shape of the alpha channel. So what you want to do next is to just track more points on the plate and add more roto. And that was the tutorial on the introduction to roto in Nuke. Of course, once you are done with your roto, you probably want to add some VFX element onto your shot. And you can get those elements anytime at actionvfx.com. At ActionVFX, we provide high quality VFX assets for your VFX needs. We have fire, explosions, energy, and many, many others. You can also sign up for our ActionVFX subscription starting at the low cost of $14.99 a month. This is the most affordable way to access our library, and you can cancel anytime, no contract.
Thank you so much for watching. I encourage you to drop a like and let us know in the comment section below what you thought of this video or if you have other tutorial ideas that you would like us to cover. Most of all, be sure to subscribe. We are aiming for 100,000 subscribers by the end of the year. And also there are a ton of other resources on our channel, such as tutorials, podcasts, VFX breakdowns, and so much more that we think you'll find valuable. This can be your home for visual effects content. So, see you next time. Bye-bye.